We're up in Lake Geneva, Wisconsin, and we've been, the last year and a half, we've been meeting out of our home, and we're planting a work there in the Lake Geneva area. So we have Friday night studies, and then we meet on Sunday mornings as well. And we got a great group of folks on Friday nights, and we're going through the book of Philemon. Randy's a part of that. And then on Sundays, we're doing 1 Thessalonians. And so I had a whole kinds of things I wanted to talk about tonight, you know, 4 or 5 different things. And then I figured I'm going to stick with Thessalonians because it's just too good to pass up. But pray for us. I guess that's why I mentioned that. Pray for us and the work there. You know, we don't have a name or anything like that. I just tell people we're the Grace Church in Lake Geneva, you know. So we're excited about the opportunities there. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 3. We began the book of Thessalonians a few weeks ago. And right now we're looking at verse 3. And we're talking about the work of faith. And what I want to do this evening is talk about the work of faith, and then we're going to go to 2 Thessalonians, and when he adds in verse 11, when Paul adds the work of faith with power. And what I want you to just keep in mind as we go through these things, one, what is the work of faith? What does he mean when he says with power? And then to demonstrate God's power throughout time. Understanding God's power in time past, now in the dispensation of grace and in the ages to come, and how God makes it known. It's a very fascinating study. So read with me 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 3. Verse 3, remembering without ceasing your work of faith and labor of love and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father. Father God, we thank you for this time of study, for the saints here, for their desire and eagerness to study and learn, and the fellowship that we share in your Son. It's in his name we pray. Amen. So when he says here to the Thessalonians, remembering without ceasing your work of faith, and then he talks about the labor of love and patience of hope, and on he goes. And this idea here, those three points, when he talks about faith, love, and hope, faith, charity, and hope in the book, those three principles, I'll refer to them as principles, are a reoccurring theme throughout 1 Thessalonians. Now, just as kind of a way of introduction so we get our minds prepped, and you've seen this here. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 13. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 13. And Paul says in 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 13, he tells Timothy, he says, hold fast the form of sound words which thou hast heard of me, and that's key, which thou hast heard of me in faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. And what Paul describes there is the form of sound words. And we were just talking about, you know, my dad, he's in the concrete business and he's a cement finisher and all that. And I remember as a teenager going to jobs with him, and we would put together forms for the, you know, pouring the cement. And that's pretty aggravating work. You know, you're just pounding stakes and, you know, not seeing much product at that point. And your back hurts at the end of the day, you know, that kind of a thing. And there's a form, there's structure. And what Paul talks about, and when he refers to his the things that he has received from Christ, he talks about the form of sound words. And he's talking about the structure and the design behind his epistles. Now, when you look at 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16, and 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, he says, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction. And he also talks about instruction in righteousness. We'll talk about that in a minute. That the man of God might be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. And what you're going to see, and we're going to talk about Thessalonians, and I want you to have this in mind as we go on, is that when you go through Paul's epistles, the first 9, he's dealing with what we call church epistles. Romans is a book of doctrine. It's going to teach you about the doctrine of God's grace, the doctrine of Calvary, what Christ has accomplished, and how we're justified by faith, and the establishing doctrines of His grace. You're going to come to 1 and 2 Corinthians, and he's going to deal with reproof. He's correcting bad behavior that is not consistent with the doctrine of grace found in Romans. And then you come to Galatians, and their correction, that's a book all these books have doctrine and all these elements in them, but there's a general flow in the book, Galatians is a book of correction about bad doctrine. They were getting caught up with legalism. They were getting caught up with law and going to an inferior system. And so he's going to correct their understanding bring them back to a grace mindset, or that's the goal. You come back to Ephesians now, and you've seen this as well. I'm just going to bring this up as a reminder here. This focuses on the cross. These books here will focus on the church. 1 and 2 Thessalonians is the doctrine about Christ's coming. Ephesians, he talks about the body of Christ, the body's heavenly purpose and their design in the ages to come there. Philippians is a book of reproof about the believer's behavior in line with Ephesians. Colossians, he's going to deal with vain deceit and philosophy and traditions of men, chapter 2. He says, let no man spoil you through philosophy, vain deceit, chapter 2, verse 8. He's going to correct the Colossians, their understanding, their bad thinking and their bad doctrine, and going to kind of recalibrate it to what they learn in Ephesians, what we learn in Ephesians. You come to 1 and 2 Thessalonians, and that's doctrine about the coming of Christ. Now, you'll also see there's a theme here. This deals with, you might not be able to see it if I write it like that, but these books here deal with faith. These books here are going to deal with the love of Christ. There's an emphasis on that. And then here is the hope that we have. Now, Ephesians, you're dealing with the body of Christ. That's you and me. Philippians, you're dealing with the mind of Christ. Colossians, the emphasis is on who Christ is as the head of the body. And by the way, you know, this is one of the things I wanted to talk to you about tonight, so I'm going to say it anyway because it's so much fun. I wanted to go over some things about Christ. He's the head of the universe. He's the head of heaven and earth. Why? See, when you understand the body's heavenly purpose, and you understand how that heavenly purpose impacts the practice of the believer as they work together in the local church, Colossians deals with Christ, the head of the universe. Why? Because he is the head of the body. Christ can't be the head of the universe without being the head of the body of Christ. That's why it's so important to understand who you are in God's program. This book here deals with the hope. Look at back to 1 Thessalonians. Now, faith, he's going to say love and hope, faith, charity, and hope. Look at verse 3 again. He says, remembering without ceasing your work of faith and labor of love and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, the book of Thessalonians, you can almost divide it in a couple ways. Chapter 1 and 2 deal with the work of faith, the Thessalonians' work of faith. Look at chapter 2, verse 13. He says in verse 13, for this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when you received the word of God which you heard of us, you received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God which effectually worketh also in you that believe. So he deals with their faith. You come on down to chapter 3, all the way through chapter 4, verse 12, he's going to deal with their labor of love. And he talks about their charity. Notice chapter 4 and verse 9. He says to them, but as touching brotherly love, ye need not that I write unto you, for ye yourselves are taught of God to love one another. You see that? So there's an emphasis, and as he progresses, chapter 4, verse 13, all the way from 5, chapter 5 to 11, he deals with specifically the coming of Jesus Christ, the timing of his coming, the details about the resurrection, and all of that. He's going to emphasize the hope. So you can almost kind of lay out the book that way. And what we're going to talk about is the work of faith. Now, grab with me 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And this is just a point about the Thessalonians that you want to have in view here. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Those principles, faith, hope, and love, those are principles of maturity. Those are marks of maturity. That as we grow in Christ and as we get the sound doctrine of God's Word in our soul and our understanding and our thinking, we grow up and we act like adults, spiritually speaking. Those are principles that operate in the believer's life. And as you go through the edification process, and as you learn about the doctrine, reproof, correction, and the instruction in righteousness that's found in God's Word, those principles are developed in the believer. Now, 1 Corinthians 13, notice here, verse 11. Now, the context here is he's dealing with spiritual gifts. And you'll notice there in verse 8, he says, charity never faileth, but whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. Now, you know he's talking about the supernatural gift, the Spirit-given gift of prophecy, of tongues, of knowledge. He says, verse 9, we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. What is the perfect that he's referring to there? He's making a contrast with what's in part. So knowledge is in part, prophecy is in part. When it's perfect, when it comes to completion, you're going to have complete prophecy, complete knowledge there. It's going to be perfect. When that which is perfect is come, and that which is in part shall be done away. Now, notice how Paul associates those spiritual gifts and how he distinguishes those things. He says, when I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. When we talk about being children, you know, you can dupe children quite easily, you know, if they don't get to you first. But, you know, children only know so much in life. They only understand so much. They speak a certain way. But as they grow and that, you know, you want to grow to maturity and then you want to continue on in maturity. And he says there, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. What is he referring to? Those spiritual gifts. If someone is operating with this idea that they have these spiritual gifts, that's childish. That's the argument he's making. Then he says, verse 12, for now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face, now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, charity, these three, but the greatest of these is charity. And he's going to talk about charity and the gifts in relationship to that in chapter 14. The point is, when we deal with faith and love and hope, those things transcend those, you know, those are the marks of maturity. The spiritual gifts, I'll put it this way, the complete revelation of God accomplishes those tasks. You don't need the gift of prophecy. Why? Because you have a complete book. You don't need the gift of tongues. Why? Because God's complete book is available in your language. You don't need partial, you know, the things that are accomplished by the spiritual gifts or were accomplished by the spiritual gifts are now accomplished, the same thing, but by the complete revelation. That's the point I want to make. But he says those three things, faith, hope, and charity, those are the things that abide, not the partial knowledge, not the partial prophecy, those things continue. And that's what is built in the believer as we grow in edification. Now, you're there in 1 Corinthians 13. Look with me at chapter 2. So when Paul says that about the Thessalonians, when he talks about that to the Thessalonians, he says, we remember your work of faith, your labor of love, your patience of hope. They are demonstrating maturity in their doctrine. Contrast that with the Corinthians here for a moment. Look at chapter 2 and verse 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 1. He says, and I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God, for I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. Now, a lot of times, and I've heard this presented this way, how wonderful is it that Paul went to the Corinthians and the only thing he wanted to talk about was Christ and him crucified? And isn't that wonderful? Because there was all these divisions and there were all these heresies going on, and he just wanted to bring unity by preaching Christ crucified. That's not the point in the verse. The point in the verse is I can't go on in the doctrine because the only thing you really get is Christ crucified. We can't build. Now notice here's the reason that it's hindered. He's not complimenting them, he's criticizing them. He says, I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom. That's what they were becoming susceptible to. He says, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. The problem in Corinth, in contrast with the Thessalonians, is that he says the Thessalonians, we saw the verse there, chapter 2, verse 13, he says, you received the word from us, you received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God. Your approach to God's book made all the difference. Now, you need to keep that in mind when we talk about the work of faith. But he says, guys, you are falling in danger, prey to the wisdom of men. And that's what's causing the division. Someone told me once, they said, you know, there was, well, I'll get into that, but someone told me once, you guys are being divisive. And you know, the stance you're taking, it was a stance on the Bible issue, it's divisive. And truth is not divisive. Now, do you buy that? No. See, truth totally divides. If you're going to stand for the truth, there's going to be an adversarial approach to it. So if you're going to stand for the faith of God's word, that's going to be a divisive thing. Here he says that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. The Corinthians did not demonstrate the work of faith. That's the point. Look at chapter 8, verse 1. Chapter 8, verse 1. He says to the Corinthians there, he says, now as touching things offered unto idols, we know that we all have knowledge. Knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. He's going to take chapter 8, 9, 10, even 11, and he's going to talk about how the believers operate together in charity. The Corinthians, they're fighting. They're divisive. The main reason for that is because they're not appreciating the apostleship of Paul, of God's spokesman in the dispensation of grace. And so they're getting carried away with this wind of doctrine, and they're getting sucked into this riptide of the course of the world, whatever you want to call it, and they're getting so bogged down and hindered by all kinds of heresies. Why? Because they're not paying attention to the doctrine that was given to them. And it's impacting their knowledge, their faith standing in the wisdom of men, not in the wisdom of God. And he says, charity edifies. And he's going to spend the next three chapters talking about what it means to walk charitably towards your brother. They had a problem with love, with charity. Look at chapter 15 and verse 13. Notice verse 12. 1 Corinthians 15, he deals with the resurrection. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 12, he says, now, if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen? And if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain. They had an issue with hope. So when you contrast the Corinthians with the Thessalonians, can I just say, in short, their attitude towards God's word made all the difference, okay? The work of faith, the labor of love, the patience of hope is not present with the Corinthians. He says in chapter 3, he says, you're carnal. A lot of times we read chapter 3 and he says, and we say, well, the Corinthians, they were as children, they were as babes in Christ. Paul doesn't say you guys are babes in Christ. He says you're carnal as babes. You are way beyond the point of acting like children. I was talking to Greg, and you know, you see all the craziness in the world, and everyone's just acting like a big baby, you know. And the answer to all that is Christ, by the way, you know. So what's the answer to all the chaos and all the selfishness and the greediness and the wickedness and the hate? You know, you want to understand the culture today? Titus chapter 3 verse 2. He says we were sometimes foolish, disobedient, serving divers lusts, hateful and hating one another. You know, what a picture. we could be awfully ugly. That's the issue. And he says, you guys, Christ is the answer. I got to get back on track. He says, you're a carnal. As babes, you guys need to grow up. But with the Thessalonians, and the reason I show you these things, just because they're important contrasts, look with me at Hebrews chapter 5. The Thessalonians were growing and responding positively to the sound doctrine of God's word. Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 14. Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 14, or verse 12. Now, we recognize the context here and the purpose of the book of Hebrews. And in the book of Hebrews, what he's doing there is he's writing to the Jewish remnant, the believing remnant, the little flock, and he's equipping them. The author, if I say Paul in Hebrews, scratch that, okay? That's not what I mean. I just, you know, I'm on autopilot a little bit. The author, the writer of Hebrews, it wasn't Paul, is exhorting them and establishing them in doctrine about better things and things to come, about Christ's kingdom, based on the crosswork of Christ. Chapter 5, notice verse 12. For when, for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk, and not of strong meat. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. So what does it say about the Corinthians? They're unskilled in the word of righteousness, you see. Now, verse 14, but strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age. And those marks of maturity that we're talking about there, you know, faith, love, and hope, those are the marks of being a full age, of being mature in the faith. He says, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. So you think about that in light of Corinthians, but also consider that in light of the Thessalonians. These are mature believers. Now, there's gaps in their understanding. Go back to 1 Thessalonians and chapter 3. And notice verse 6. You know, it's nice when you can say of other saints, you know, and you can appreciate and give thanks to God for their understanding in the grace of God, for their maturity in the grace of God. That's a wonderful thing. Notice what he says here about the Thessalonians in chapter 3, verse 6, or verse 5. He says, for this cause, when I could no longer forbear, I sent to know your faith, lest by some means the tempter have tempted you, and our labor be in vain. But now, when Timotheus came from you unto us, and brought us good tidings of your what? Of your faith and charity, what's missing? The hope's missing. Now, he says, he acknowledges their patience of hope, but the book of 1 and 2 Thessalonians is doctrine about Christ's coming. They had some gaps in their understanding about the resurrection. They didn't deny the resurrection, they didn't deny their hope, but they needed some further understanding. That's what the book of Thessalonians is about. Now, back to verse 3 of chapter 1, when he says there, remembering without ceasing your work of faith and labor of love and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ, the way you want to, you know, need to understand that is he's focusing on the source. So in other words, he's talking about work motivated by faith. Faith is the source. It produces this work. Labor, the labor of love, love is the source. Labor is what's motivated by love. The patience, the ability to endure difficulty, is motivated by our hope. You see that? So what he's doing is he's emphasizing the source of those things. And he's going to talk about the work of faith and labor of love, what that all looks like, but he's not so much focused on the details of those things as he is the source. Now, the work of faith, look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. What he's referring to there is the activity, the practice, the work that's motivated by trusting God's word. It's the word of God that effectually worketh in you that believe. And that's what he's referring to now. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. Now, there's a term he uses in 2 Thessalonians. There's an additional thing he adds that you don't find in 1 Thessalonians. Now, he's emphasizing some points here because the persecution, the trouble is kind of, you know, is being dialed up. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 11, he says, wherefore also we pray always for you that our God would count you worthy of this calling and fulfill all the good pleasure of his goodness and the work of faith with power. So he adds that with power. Now, is that to say that the work of faith in 1 Thessalonians is without power? No. He's bringing something up. Now, look at the verse carefully. He says, we pray always for you that our God would count you worthy of this calling and fulfill all the good pleasure of his goodness. So right there, just stop right there for a moment. God is counting worthy. God is fulfilling the good pleasure of his goodness. Who's fulfilling the work of faith? When he says with power, he's emphasizing the fact that it's God working in you as you respond in faith to God's word. The power isn't just external compulsion or just yielding to some sort of legalistic standard. Rather, it's the word of God in you that produces the ability. You see that? Grab Philippians chapter 2. What he's referring to there is God working in what he is doing today. And when we respond positively to the word of God, when we have faith in the sound doctrine of God's word, God is able to work. And I tell people, look, get in God's book and let it get in you. You see the difference there? He says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. And there are so many distractions in the world. There are so many things that pull us away. And you think, you know, not to be, I don't want to be insensitive or say anything that's not, you know, recognizing hardship that this year has brought. 2020, you know, I was just talking to a friend the other day, and I said, wasn't, you know, 2019 was a really great year. I really miss 2019. And you know, people say all kinds of things about this year. It started off pretty rough, and it's kind of bumpy, isn't it? And I don't mean to be insensitive, but I think 2020 has been rather nice. Why? Not because of my circumstances. Not because of my job or you know, things around that. Things have slowed down. You know, things aren't all that great. I don't want to sound, you know, like I'm not sympathetic to the real legitimate struggles that people are going through as a result of all this craziness. But when you get in God's word and you just let that impact your focus on things, it is a liberating thing. And I think too often we let the distractions and the pessimism and just the chaos in the world take us away from our comfort, from our security, from our resource. And when that happens, you know, we just live like, you know, Charlie Brown. just totally discouraged and upset. And, you know, when you see injustices in the world and when you see you know, whether it's the heavy hand of government, and you see, injustices in the culture, all of that business, you can look at that and legitimately say, that's wrong. Isn't that nice? You ought to be upset about certain things. You ought to be upset about injustice. But the answer isn't rioting and stealing and looting and all that craziness that you see. You read Romans chapter 1, and he talks about the unrighteousness of man. And there's a word in there, I think I'm pronouncing it right. He talks about being implacable. You're unable to be appeased. You're never satisfied. That's the world you live in, where you say one thing on the internet, it haunts you, and there's no atonement, there's no forgiveness, and it's just crucify, crucify, crucify. Where are you going to find forgiveness? In Christ. Where are you going to find the answer? It's all in Christ. So what does the world need? Not my anger, not my frustration, not all that stuff, needs Christ. That's the only answer. So I say all that. You can't do the work of faith with power getting caught up on other things. Get in God's book and let it get a grip on your heart. Now, verse 13, Philippians 2, verse 13. He says, for it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Now, people do silly things with this verse. This isn't some sort of, you know, Calvinistic nonsense that, you know, you don't have a free will or that kind of a thing. What he's talking about there is when you get in God's word, remember, it's the word of God which effectually worketh in you that believe. That's what he's talking about. So those are good cross references. He says, it's God which worketh in you both to will. When I get in God's word and I let the word of Christ dwell in me richly and I got my focus on that, I begin to appreciate and love and value the things that God loves and values. You see that? And then he says, and do of his good pleasure. Where do I get the ability to carry out the will of God? From his word working in me. From his life working in me. Now that's not just something he zaps you with. That's something as you respond in faith. See, that's the work of faith with power. Can I say it that way? Now, that word, when he says, talks about with power, That's where we get the English word dynamite, you know, dynamite. And that ability, look at a couple examples here. Look at Matthew chapter 3, verse 9, and Acts chapter 20. Matthew chapter 3, verse 9. And I want to spend some time looking at this issue of power, of the power of God. Matthew chapter 3, and just give you an example of how this idea works. Matthew chapter 3, verse 9. Now here's John the Baptist, and he's having a good time with the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And he says, verse 7, "But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth therefore fruits meet for repentance. And think not to say within yourselves, We have Abraham to our father. For I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham." When he talks about power in Thessalonians, that's the same word he's using there in Matthew. He's talking about God's ability. Now, don't get caught up on the stones and, you know, all that stuff. He's talking about God's able to do something. When he says that you might be strengthened by his Spirit with might, that's that word, in the inner man. Remember something, your Christian life is not something that works on the basis of external compulsion or external pressure. It's internal transformation. So it starts in the heart first. And a lot of times we get into this idea that I got to do something to prove my faith. And man, you get into that mindset, you're going to lose. You're going to be frustrated. You're going to be disappointed. That's Romans 7 deals with all that stuff. It's an inward transformation. It's faith in God's word, and then the work is produced. And it's God which worketh in you, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. That's the power. I said Matthew chapter 3. Look at Acts chapter 20. This is a really cool verse here, Acts chapter 20. And verse 32. He says, "And now, brethren, I commend you to God, and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them that are sanctified." There's that word able again. That's the idea. Okay, that's the word there. God is able. Where do you find the power of God? Here he says it's in the word of his grace. And what he's talking about specifically is the ministry and the message that was committed to him. Now, come with me to Romans chapter 9. This issue of God's power, his ability, his might. You're going to see all those words, and all those things are related there when you study the scriptures. Look at Romans chapter 9, verse 17. Now, the context of Romans chapter 9 is he's dealing with, in the book of Romans, he's dealing with Israel, you know, God postponing the fulfillment of Israel's promises. And you ever ask the question, you know, what gives God the right to do X? Now that sounds like a silly question because he's God and, you know, we're just us. But when you understand something about God's righteousness and his integrity and his holiness, that's not really an unreasonable question to want to understand. What gives God the right to stop what he's doing with Israel and then do something else? Romans 9 explains that. God reserves the right to postpone the fulfillment of prophecy and pursue another purpose. And so that's what he's talking about there in Romans 9. Romans 9, 10, 11 deal with God's dealings with Israel today. When you come to look at verse 17. And what he does is he goes through kind of a real brief history throughout of Israel. And he comes to this point and he says, "For the scripture saith unto Pharaoh." Now he's quoting Exodus 9, and I want to say it's verse 16. Exodus 9, 16. He says, "For the scripture saith unto Pharaoh, Even for this same purpose have I raised thee up, that I might show my power in thee, and that my name might be declared throughout all the earth. So when you go, when you want to find the power of God in prophecy, when you want to find the power of God, God's ability, God's might, God's strength to redeem his people, to save his people, to deliver his people, and to deal with the nations, what's the measure of that, the standard of that? And you go throughout the you know, whether it's Israel's historical books and prophecy, and they use the Exodus as a standard. You'll see that time and again. We'll give you a couple examples of that. Come with me to Joshua chapter 2. Joshua, actually look at, oh goodness, how are we going to do this? Look at the passage there in Exodus first, Exodus 9, where he quotes that verse. Exodus chapter 9. What you got to realize, and this is important, is when we talk about God's power and how God demonstrated his power, it hasn't always been the same. And Exodus chapter 9, and we read there in verse 15. He says, now, Exodus 9, 15, for now I will stretch out my hand that I may smite thee and thy people with pestilence, and thou shalt be cut off from the earth. And in very deed for this cause have I raised thee up, for to show in thee my power, and that my name may be declared throughout all the earth. As yet exaltest thou thyself against my people, that thou wilt not let them go. Behold, tomorrow, about this time, I will cause it to rain a very grievous hail, such hath not been in Egypt since foundations thereof, even until now, and on he goes. And there's all these series of judgments that God pours out on Egypt to demonstrate his power, his might, and his ability to redeem his people. Look at chapter 12, Exodus chapter 12. Why does he do that? This is also in view in Romans chapter 9 when you study through it. Why didn't God just take Israel right out of Egypt from the beginning? Ever wonder? There's a purpose behind it. Exodus chapter 12, and I want to say it is verse... Oh, there are some verses you don't plan to go to until you're dumb enough to think about it and you can't find the verse. Exodus chapter 12, and verse 12. Got lucky. Exodus 12, verse 12. He says, for I will pass through the land of Egypt this night and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against, now this is the part you need to notice, and against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. The reason God delays delivering Israel out of Egypt, and what he does is this series of judgments, the pestilence, the hail, the river and blood, all of that, the death of the firstborn, is God is demonstrating who is Lord of lords and God of gods. And he's going to make an example out of Egypt and out of their gods to demonstrate to all the nations when Israel goes into their land who has the might, who has the power, who has legitimate strength. He is the living God Almighty. And he says, I'm going to execute judgment. I am the Lord. Look at Joshua chapter 2. Here's what I want you to see. When the nations in Israel's midst, when they see God executing judgment and wrath, do you realize? Now, here's the point. God is showing his power. God is showing his strength, his might, his ability through judgment, through wrath. And when you go through prophecy and you study and you look at Israel's history, the way God demonstrates who he is and his might is by judgment and wrath. Now, he's also demonstrating many other things, but when the nations look at who the living and true God is, they can look at the Exodus as kind of the baseline. Look at Joshua chapter 2, and notice verse 9. And this is the passage here about Rahab. Joshua chapter 2 and verse 9, and she says to the spies here, she says, and she said unto the men, I know, this is Rahab, she said unto the men, I know that the Lord hath given you the land, and that your terror is fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land faint because of you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when ye came out of Egypt, and what ye did unto the two kings of the Amorites and that were on the other side of the Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom ye utterly destroyed, giants in the land. That's under Moses. And as soon as we had heard these things, our hearts did melt. Neither did there remain any more courage in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and in earth beneath. Isn't that a great testimony? Now, I want you to notice here, verse 12 and 13, she says, Now therefore I pray you, swear unto me by the Lord, since I have showed you kindness, that you will also show kindness unto my father's house and give me a true token. Now this is Rahab. And that you will save alive my father and my mother and my brethren and my sisters and all that they have and deliver our lives from death. We were talking about this on Sunday. Do you know who Rahab gave birth to, right? Boaz. Isn't that cool? You read the genealogy of Christ? That's his mother. Father's Day's coming up, you know? But it got me thinking about this verse. It talks about, now Rahab doesn't mention her husband in this passage. Kind of indicates maybe she wasn't married yet. She's married to a man named Salmon. That's Boaz's father. And what I find really interesting, this is just kind of too cool to pass up. Do you ever wonder why someone as principled and prominent and respected as Boaz had such a caring heart towards Ruth, a Gentile woman? His mother was a Gentile woman. Isn't that great? So, you know, take notice how you treat your mom, and if you got daughters, I got three. You know, if the guy's a creep towards his mom, he's going to be a creep towards you. You know, it's a pretty safe bet. And look at Boaz. Look at Ruth. It's just really neat. What's kind of fascinating, too, is when you study this passage out, the father and the mother and the brethren are included, and the sisters aren't mentioned. So, you know, you think about her history and who she is as a harlot, that's kind of an interesting point. That's just for your study, okay? I'm just teasing you. You need to study that. Good time to do that. The point is, when she recognizes who the true God is, she says, we know because of what you did in Egypt, we know the power of your God, and he's worthy. And she recognizes that because of God's judgment against Egypt and that impending judgment that's coming on the rest of those nations in that land. What about in the ages to come? Grab Isaiah 59. So you go through, again, you go through these verses, you're going to see God delivering Israel out of Egypt time and again when he's demonstrating his power. Look at Isaiah chapter 59. Now again, this is prophecy. And what's God going to do in the future? And how is he going to demonstrate his power and his might? Grab Isaiah 59 and also Revelation chapter 19. And we got to wind down. Isaiah 59 and verse 16. Isaiah 59 verse 16. And he saw that there was no man, and wondered that there was no intercessor. Therefore his arm brought salvation unto him, and his righteousness is sustained him. Now who is he talking about here in this passage? It's the Lord Jesus Christ. For he put on righteousness as a breastplate, and a helmet of salvation upon his head. He put on the garments of vengeance for clothing, and was clad with zeal as a cloak. According to their deeds, accordingly he will repay. Fury to his adversaries, recompense to his enemies, to the islands he will repay recompense. So shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west, and his glory from the rising of the sun. When the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. And the Redeemer shall come to Zion, and unto them that turn from transgression in Jacob, saith the Lord. For as for me, this is my covenant with them, saith the Lord, my spirit that is upon thee, and that my words which I have put in thy mouth shall not depart out of thy mouth, nor out of the mouth of thy seed, nor out of thy mouth of thy seed's seed, saith the Lord, from henceforth and forever. And that is a prophecy about the Lord Jesus Christ redeeming his people, demonstrating his strength and his power. Come with me to Revelation 19. How is God going to demonstrate his power, his might, his strength in the ages to come? Revelation 19. It's going to be that fulfillment of prophecy. Now notice verse 11. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him that was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with the vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. You've got to keep that in mind. When God demonstrates his power, it's through the Word of God. It's through what he says. Now, it's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. There, again, there's that fulfillment of that passage there in Isaiah 59. Verse 15, and out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness of the wrath of the Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And on he goes. The way God reveals his power and his might and his ability to redeem, just like he did back there with Egypt, that was a dress rehearsal of all this. He shows his power and his strength through judgment, through wrath, and deliverance of Israel. I bring that up so you can see how God shows his power today in the dispensation of grace. And it's really kind of a sobering thought. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 17. For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved it is the power of God. He goes on, for it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. I mean, don't you like how he says that in verse 21? How does the world get rid of God? We're going to come up with some pseudo-intellectualism to explain him away and make you look foolish for trusting him. That looks weak, doesn't it? Notice verse 22. For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. Why do the Jews require a sign? They don't believe God's word. Why do the Greeks seek after wisdom? Because they won't believe God's word. He says, verse 25, or verse 24, but unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. Grab with me, hold your hand here in 2 Corinthians 1, or 1 Corinthians 1 rather. Look at 2 Corinthians 13. There's just something so unique about the dispensation in which you live, where God demonstrates his power and his might in quite a different way today. Look at 2 Corinthians 13. In verse 3, 2 Corinthians 13, verse 3, he says, since ye seek a proof of Christ speaking in me, which to you word is not weak, but is mighty in you, for though he was crucified through weakness, yet he liveth by the power of God. For we also are weak in him, but we shall live with him by the power of God toward you. Back to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. He goes on in verse 26. He says, for you see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty, and the base things of the world, and the things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and things which are not, to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. How does God demonstrate his power today? Not by his judgment, not by his wrath. He demonstrates it through a message that appears weak, that appears foolish, the preaching of the cross. And God demonstrates the power of his word working in the believer today through weak earthen vessels. That is an amazing thing, and that's a uniquely characteristic of the dispensation of grace. Look at 2 Corinthians 12, and we need to finish here. 2 Corinthians 12, verse 8. Verse 7. Paul says, "And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong." When you go through the Pauline epistles, what you see time and again is that the way God makes his power known, and by the way, when we're talking about the power of God, remember, he makes it known through the Word of God, rightly divided, okay? That the sound doctrine, that good doctrine. And the power of God's word works in weak people. So when you feel weak and you feel insufficient, and you know, so, and it's so unfortunate, Christendom at large wants to experience God. Isn't that right? I want to know God. I want to have his presence in my life. And little do they know, you have the life of Christ. You have it. It's just letting it grow and develop in you and doing the work of faith with power. God makes his strength and his power known through his word in our weakness. That's how he works today. Not his judgment, not his wrath, but his grace, the sufficiency of his grace. And you just got to get in, you know, we all need to just kind of wrap our minds around the fact that he is our resource. He's it. And if you look for answers, and you know, he says, "In whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge? Christ your head." And when we depart from the sufficiency that we have in Christ, from the grace that we stand in, and we allow ourselves to get caught up with all kinds of nonsense in the world, we're living so below our heavenly calling. When we get wrapped up in silliness and contentions and paranoia and conspiracies and anger and all these things that you don't have an answer for, it's Christ, our life. It's the strength of God, the power of God, begins in the preaching of the cross, and then that life and that power is made known as we walk by faith in his word. That is liberating. I don't have to worry. I don't have to live full of anxiety. I can be weak and know that Christ is my power. He's my answer. Father, we thank you for your word, for your power, the power that works in us, for the privilege to labor with you in the work of the ministry. And I just pray that as we study, as we learn, that we be intentional to know your word, that we study and learn on purpose and with purpose, and to see Christ's life formed in us, so that as we exercise faith in your word, that life and that power is put on display for those around us. We thank you for your grace. Amen.